So thank you both, Narelle and Claire, for those amazing presentations. It was beautiful to see the video examples and some lovely examples of best practice where people with deafblindness are given time and opportunity to orient, recognising what that looks like for each individual. The examples of tactile communication, both on video and that Claire described, were beautiful to hear. Claire's reflection on if I knew then what I knew now, how my practice would have been different. And I think that's a process that just is ongoing for all of us. As we learn more, our practice changes. And the importance of the O&M in a team for anyone with deafblindness and how much they can bring to that space and educate not only the person with deafblindness, but the whole team. So thank you both for that. I would like, I'm just checking, keeping an eye on the Q&A. So there's one starting rolling. Before that, I probably got a question of my own. So I was writing down questions as I went along, but as the webinar proceeded, I actually answered a lot or addressed a lot myself. I'm wondering if I can put this question to you. As O&M instructors, primarily you are trained to service people with blindness, but not necessarily trained to service people with deafblindness. So I'm wondering, throughout your career, are there any strategies that you would have been trained in that you rely less on because of when you're working with someone with deafblindness, and what you might do instead? So I'll give that one to Narelle first, unless Claire wants to jump in there.
So communication is influenced in such a big way, and so that might, for me, with a large caseload at the moment, that might influence the way that I work with the team. And so in the past, where I may have had more time, I would really be working regularly with the student and building my own relationship with the student. At the moment, my caseload is really large, so I have to respect that I'm not always up to speed with what the student needs. And so I'm better off having a role where I'm not working directly but influencing the key people who are doing the work. And additionally, the amount of time I would use auditory information and verbal description in working with blind students, and it's such an important strategy. And so for the student with deafblindness, I might be exaggerating some of the auditory sensory information if that's available, really paying attention to perhaps the qualities of those spaces in terms of really big echoes and paying close attention to what the student can gather, and really being mindful that I have to see what the student is finding is important. So it might be really digging down on the tactual information, because I think that is often just the most important for these learners.
And Claire, do you have something to add to that?
I think just when I started studying O&M, there's a lot of emphasis on work, if you're just working with blind, low vision people, on body autonomy and not touching people. And I had come from a place of using a lot of communication, a lot of haptic stuff. And so I think it's just knowing that you can establish that that's okay, because I think that a lot of people who are blind or have low vision, they'll get manhandled. And so there's within just the blind, low vision kind of thinking, you can think, oh, if you pick someone up and you steer them by their shoulders, then it's terrible. And I agree, it is absolutely terrible, but that some touch can be okay, and that it can be a very useful thing. And even with clients that I have that are not deafblind, touch can be a useful thing used correctly and negotiated in ways that feel safe and give that person full control. So I think it's just, you know, in a deafblind space, touch is everything. And in a blind low vision space, it seems like it's quite a known, almost like a no-no. So I would just encourage O&Ms to think that in a safe, considered way, that touch could be really important in learning. Mm. That's my takeaway.
Yeah, some beautiful insights there. Teamwork, communication, and the increased role of well-chosen touch to add information and support learning. Thanks so much. We've got some questions coming in from our audience, so I'm going to move to them now. From Phoebe, we've got, do occupational therapists often work in orientation and mobility? It sounds a lot like a lot of areas we focus on, example, the environment. Yep. So maybe I'll go Narelle and Claire, and we'll just take that order. Yep. Unless you want to pass the question on.
I understand that, Phoebe. I think you're definitely considering the environment, particularly in those early years. I think it's the nature of development. Development is so enmeshed. It has all those different areas, and it's really up to the learner which they'll be paying close attention to. And developing, we can't control that, but we provide the best environments to enable that learning to occur. But I also know that the lens that the O&M will place over the learning is quite different from the lens that the occupational therapist will place over that learning. I know that I need to collaborate with an occupational therapist to understand, you know, the work of the hands and the learning that's occurring. I would not think that you would have perhaps the same, even though you would have some knowledge, you would not have the same depth of knowledge in actually understanding the spatial learning that's required and the conditions and the evidence that is determining success in some of those areas. Definitely important that we all work together.
Yep. I think, and I think that kind of holds true across all disciplines.
Yeah.
That brings their own perspective. And then you've got to shed that deafblind lens over that perspective as mm-hmm. well. Yeah. Thanks, Narelle. Claire, was there anything you wanted to add there?
Just supporting, yeah, let's work together. I think it's, I guess when you're thinking about congenitally deafblind people, you're thinking about areas like homes and day centres and potentially those sorts of contained spaces. So there's a huge crossover between that and also your motivation to move. Are you moving from a place to make a cup of tea, for example, or to, you know, and that's where that huge crossover is that where you're moving to might have another purpose as well. That's more OT. But yeah, let's work together.
Great. And from Jane, what are your thoughts regarding AFOs during mobility for children who are deafblind? I'm aware of how much information he, so they've got a particular person or student in mind, takes in through his feet versus how much ankle stability he requires.
Oh, such a good question, Jane. You know, I think we have to think of the balance. It's certainly important. Both of those things are important. And so I think we really need to allow times both for the student to be developing some of their skill where they're getting that additional support that's helping their body to develop with a good pattern. But we also need to be able to allow those feet to do the work to support the learner to know where they are and to make the rich comparisons that bring meaning to their world.
Claire, did you have anything to add?
No, that is not, that's a question for Narelle.
yeah. And I think, you know, so often we have to weigh up the pros and cons in each and really consider, you know, what we're leaving out by following one particular strategy sort of only. And often the child, if you let the child lead, they will show you what information they need and what information is important to them. And then once they've gathered that, maybe they would then be sort of more willing to wear the AFOs because they've gathered that information and now they, you know, they can use it that way. And then back on my AFOs, it's a really hard one, isn't it, all that juggle and that balance. But thanks, Jane, for that great question. From Lita, so this is a question about echolocation and maybe any alternatives for someone with deafblindness. So echolocation being I think I'll get the OMNMs to describe that more accurately. So they recently heard that a person with deafblindness can perhaps get a sense of vibration or their environment through other senses other than hearing, in the way that a blind person with full hearing or adequate hearing might get that through echolocation. Can you talk to that at all?
Yes. So echolocation is a reflected sound, and it can be active or passive. So it can be a sound that's just coming from the structure in the environment, or it can be active where the learner is perhaps making a clap or a little click with their tongue to really actively create that echo. And that information tells them about the structure and what's in that environment. So when you're talking about, I'm unsure what you're talking about. So there are a couple of different things. So there, if you've got somebody with good concepts or developing concepts, there's a mobility, there are some mobility aids that send out a beam, and that's converted to tactual information, and that can be motivating and interesting for some learners. A device like Mini Guide, as an example. If you're talking about the reverberation that you might feel tactually from, say, a large sound source, I don't think there's really great research. I can tell that this is being gathered by students, even students that have no hearing at all, but I'm not sure if it gives good information about distance or direction. I'm curious myself about the functional implications around that sensory information. More questions than answers there, Melanie.
Yep. And
I feel similarly, but I also think that it's exciting. I think there's going to be stuff developed in this. Like I know with Microsoft Soundscape had an app that gives you that sort of 3D sound. It's being sort of refurbished at the moment as an app, and it gave that 3D sound, but they converted it to haptic feedback. So you got stronger vibrations at different distances. So similar things like that. So I think there's stuff coming that will really expand how we think about feeling our environment. If we can start to think about hearing our environment 3D, what does it feel like to feel our environment in 3D potentially with technology. It's a new area, but I think it's exciting to think about how you might be able to paint a picture of how big things are. And I do think also people, this isn't echolocation, but people will have a sense of the heaviness of buildings by feel. You know, you can feel that compression of buildings or that compression of walls and things like that, that is like a feeling thing. Yeah.
And there we go, that kind of increased role for touch and information that we get through touching. Yeah, terrific. Thanks for that question. We have another one now. Thank you for your presentation. At what point should we refer someone to see an O&M specialist, specifically for adults who still have functional vision and expecting to lose vision later in life, such as in Usher syndrome?
Do you want to go? I think that if anything comes out of this presentation today, I think it's refer. If in doubt, just refer. Like, I think that I don't know the person you're talking about, so I don't know their details, but I would say a lot of people don't know about O&M so much. Well, I didn't. And I would just say refer and talk to somebody about it. Obviously talk to the client and the client's family, but if in doubt, refer. I think it's the more brains on this, the better. And I think it's an area that we're still learning about, you know.
Yep. And I'd even say as soon as you know about that diagnosis, regardless of their age, start having those conversations so that you're equipped with the information and you can make decisions from there. And I think even, you know, when children are born, even before they're moving, you know, moving out of their own space by themselves, that there's really rich and valuable information and perspective that an O&M can offer in terms of how you set up a play space, how you start to help them understand where they are, where they're going, where they've been moved to, how they're moved, all those things. I think O&Ms can provide really valuable insights.
Yeah, Melanie, we start working with our students in the area of O&M from as early as possible in our play group and early intervention environments.
Yeah. A few affirmations then. Thank you. Working together is great. Another question. How would an O&M work for someone with CVI, so cerebral or cortical vision impairment, and cerebral palsy, so that combination, which is often a common combination or co-diagnosis, in a wheelchair?
So, yeah, absolutely, very relevant to be involving your O&M with a student who has these really complex needs. And it's, again, that we need to know our learners individually and then add in the, you know, the correct strategies and environments to move their learning along. We have students who use canes in wheelchairs when they're moving in certain areas or when to extend their reach while they're building their knowledge of their environment. It's really important to give these students access. We typically move people in wheelchairs really fast through spaces, and if they're a complex learner, we really need to slow it down, consider the complexity of their vision, consider the access that they have with their physical capabilities, and bring that all together.
Is that an experience you want to shed any more light on, Claire? It's a challenging combination there.
I have not done a lot of work in CVI space. What I would know is working with something that that client can attend to, so that there is that motivation to explore more. So whether that be the shiny thing or the you know, the thing that somebody is attending to be able to reach or move toward. But there are some wonderful practitioners in who have a lot more experience in the CVI space. So yeah. That, yep. I recommend you hit them up for advice.
And I think it's definitely worth the conversation. I've I've heard of cane training for people with CVIs, particularly navigating through depth and understanding depth, etc. Yeah, go on, Narelle.
Oh, just saying, absolutely, Meredith. And also, you know, I see with learners that I work with, canes can come in and out if you've got a CVI diagnosis, particularly when the environment changes, particularly when there's less familiarity or when anxiety's up or when perhaps the auditory information might be maybe too much, and so you might be paying closer attention to the tactile information.
Have you ever done cane training for someone in a wheelchair? Are there options for that?
Yes, definitely. We have canes for wheelchairs and walkers. For students, anything that's really connecting them to the environment. And we, again, really look at the individual to get that just right. But we see students highly motivated to be finding that cane and checking out the distance they are, the textures, the sounds, through the perception of the long cane. I have some beautiful videos of different ways students might develop those skills. It can often, if they're complex learners, it can often look really different to a traditional cane program.
Mm-hmm. Great. Next question from Ben. What is the state of the workforce for O&M practitioners? We know that many other deafblind supporters are in critically short supply. Is this the same? Is this true for this space? What are the impacts of this on building consistent relationships so pivotal to achieve the best outcomes?
We need like a talking stick. There is a new course running through the University of New South Wales. It's very small, like you know everybody. Like I checked the names as we came on and it was like, oh, I know these people. It's a very, very small field. There are the new course running through the University of New South Wales is bringing in a lot of, I guess, for want of a better expression, new blood, new people, young people coming through, which is great. I know both Narelle and I have students that are going through that program at the moment. But it is small. And that's why I sort of did a little plug, I guess, in talking is we want to keep the profession going. Narelle, do you have anything you want to add?
Just really happy that there is a course available at the moment. In Australia, we've had many years where there hasn't been a course. So I think there's been a real change in O&M being an opportunity as a career with NDIS funding becoming available. I can see we have a lot, if you look on the OMAA website, there's a list of private practitioners who might be a member, you know, and they sometimes will highlight their areas of interest or expertise.
So if you're thinking of changing or expanding your career, the O&M course might be for you. Jump on board and join. Now we have a big complicated question here, which I'm going to read through slowly. The brain is firing here, putting O&M together with vision and auditory functioning. Absolutely, it'll keep firing for a long time. What considerations do you make to get ready for guiding or communicating with someone who is deafblind? For example, I'm thinking that one does not touch a deaf person when they can't hear you, and you're in their space. If we know the functional vision, e.g. awareness of light, do we move into that, inverted commas, light space so they know there's a presence and then can guide or communicate with touch? am I on reasonable track here?
You are. Your brain is so firing in the right places. Exactly right. If the learner has some functional vision, we may maximize that in terms of our own positioning to allow them to have access to that visual information to know that we're nearby. If the learner doesn't have enough functional vision to be able to know that we're nearby, we might contact them in a really consistent way, to be offering them that we're nearby without really imposing ourselves on that learner. If the learner has some functional hearing that may be of use, we might also use that as a way to support them to indicate that we're nearby.
I think that putting a hand near someone's hand as an offering to communicate or to have a session is a really good way. But that just made me think of a really interesting point that I thought about at the Deafblind Conference. I saw somebody there that I worked with many years ago, and I was excited to see this person, and I was saying hello. And afterwards, I thought, I just thought about how, like, we had this conversation, it was lovely to chat, but I thought how, you know, in that space it was quite an exhausting thing, and that person had been touched for a long period of time. And I sort of, my reflection as I walked away was like, oh, that you are always with somebody, and maybe picking and choosing when and how you want to communicate with someone in context of that, that physicalness of being on someone's body is a lot. Yeah, that was just a reflection I had, and particularly thinking about where we've come from with COVID, putting yourself on near somebody physically when they may not want it and may not have the ability to consent to it in the same way. So I don't know, that's been my reflection post-COVID, is thinking about people's physical space and having people in it and picking and choosing when and where.
I also think taking the time to identify yourself to the person. So whether that's by a tactual identifier or a sign on their body, or from a shared experience and an understanding of where you meet and the work that you do. I think it's really important to slow that part of any connection down.
Yep. And I think in those initial stages, that the kind of negotiation for, you know, what is the right way to approach you and let you know that I'm here, which might vary from person to person, even if they've got the same, you know, kind of hearing vision levels, their way that their approach might vary from individual to individual. And once you've established that, then there's, you know, everybody knows, okay, this is the way we do it for this person. Yeah. I'm going to squeeze in one more question. So it's a question about caseload, I think, about getting the necessary experience for deafblindness and the numbers on your caseload. And maybe if you could kind of give that as a full-time equivalent, even if you're not necessarily full-time.
I think it's probably different across each state as well. So the information that I can give is really from an Education Queensland point of view. And I know even the model that occurs in different states, even in the different educational departments, is different. So in Australia, I think we have teachers trained in O&M in Queensland, in South Australia and Tasmania, in school spaces. In the other states, they're partnering with different organisations to be putting that support in place. In Queensland, the Department of Education also funds some additional supports through Vision Australia and guide dogs. We're thin on the ground. Our caseloads are large. We have a lot of requests in education. Mm.
And Claire, you work in a different sector, so.
Yes, I think So I work across the NDIS and across contracted out to schools as well. And I think it definitely changes state by state. I think, at Guide Dogs Victoria, I had only a children's caseload and it was much smaller. Now I have a mixed caseload and it's quite large. I've had caseloads range from 27 to 80, depending on what's happening, and that can fluctuate at times of year. And then seasonally, you also find yourself quite busy when the weather is good, and then a lot of cancellations when the weather is bad. Just for me moving to Perth, who would have thought that Melbourne would be more hospitable, but it was because the rain wasn't so fat and ploppy. Whereas the rain here in Perth, it's there's not a lot you can do often sometimes. So that fluctuates how busy I am.
I think the travel component is really taken into consideration as well. We have students in really remote regional areas across Australia. And I think, that, again, puts another challenge to those programs.
Right. Thank you, Narelle. I'm going to wind up the webinar now. You audience, you will see a QR code there for feedback or alternative URL on screen, which is also in the chat. So I'd love you to take a few minutes to provide your feedback to us. I thank Claire and Narelle for their generosity in preparing the presentation today and sharing their insights and experience. And particularly in their busy schedules, finding time to meet when they live on opposite sides of the country to bring together today's wonderful presentation. Thank you so much. I would also like to thank our interpreters, Sarah Kennywell and Kat Edmonds, and our captioner, Lee Smith, for your support today to make this webinar as accessible as possible. So thanks again, and I will close the webinar now. We'll see you next one.